Hi everyone, welcome. So today we'll just take about 45 minutes to talk about MSF, who we are as an organization, and then Mark will talk about his experience in the field as a logistician. So we look forward to, we're going to just start the presentation with who we are as an organization and how you go about applying. So let me just show you a couple of slides. So this is me in South Sudan and in Malawi. So I was a logistician in the field, and now I'm a recruiter. And the reason why I choose these slides is the one on the left is me changing the brakes of a Land Cruiser, and this is something I hadn't done before I got to the field. So one of the things that we're looking for in people applying to the organization is really this idea of flexibility and adaptability and availability. So let's just talk a little bit more about the organization. So who are we as an organization? So we're a emergency medical humanitarian organization that treats people in basically their darkest times. So in time of trauma, epidemic, natural disasters, really when people need medical attention and the organization can be of support. And so I think really one big part of the organization is to really, what our driving principles is really our charter. And so this next slide just lets you know what our charter is, and I'll go a little bit more into detail about certain principles. And so we have principles of neutrality, impartiality, and independence. And we do, we serve populations or give...
Hello, everyone. Oh, 1 minute. I think we're having some lag time. If you could all just let us know, can you hear us? Is the video showing? If you could just leave us a comment, let us know if you can see the video and if it's coming through on your side. Looks like we've got a few people watching. So just leave us a comment. Let us know if everything looks like it's good on your end. You can hear us. All right. Great. Excellent. Okay. Sorry, miss. Sorry to interrupt.
Oh, no worries.
All right. Go ahead and take it over.
Okay. So basically, our charter are guiding principles of what orients the organization. So as we provide assistance to populations in distress, but we do that around using principles of neutrality, impartiality, and independence. And so just talk a little bit about how this organization, Doctors Without Borders, sets itself apart. And so what does it mean to be independent? It really means that as an organization, we're financially independent. And so it means we don't take any funding that we feel would undermine the work that we do. So no government, no U.S. government funding, no pharmaceutical funding, no arms industry funding, anything that we feel would have some influence of our medical operations, we don't take funding from. So it really allows us to make medical decisions based on the needs from what we're seeing on the ground, from what the patients need, rather than a donor agency telling us what are the needs and what we need to respond to. Another one of our principles is neutrality. So it means we don't take sides on a conflict. So it means that we're really trying to just be there to provide the medical services to those who need us most first. And again, that another principle of the organization is impartiality. And really it means that we're treating those who have the most acute needs first. So it means often in the field for our medical professionals, it means we're going to be seeing a lot of women and children or the most vulnerable populations in our health structures. So where do we work around the world? So we have medical programs in over 70 countries. The majority of our programs are in Africa, Middle East, Southeast Asia, and then some in Europe, Americas, and the Pacific. 62% of all of our programs are due to conflict or internal instability, and 38% of our programming are in stable contexts. And we have about 41,000 field positions. And of those, the majority of the people that we hire are locally hired from the communities that we work. So if you're thinking about working with us, who are we looking for? What do we want? If you're thinking about working in the field. And we're really looking for that flexibility. So we're looking for people who aren't afraid of everything changing from one day to the next. As Bonnie said, she's one of our field workers. Not because we're a disorganized organization, but it's really because often in the field, things are changing at a very rapid pace. So for example, you may be working in a clinic treating patients with HIV, but then there's a cholera outbreak. And so really this idea of being flexible with your skills and flexible with your scope of your work, because it is changing. So who do we recruit? As you can read the slide right here, but physicians, nurses, so RNs and NPs, midwives, and then for our OR staff, we have surgeons, OBGYNs, nurse anesthetists, and anesthesiologists, and then epidemiologists, pharmacists, mental health officers, laboratory technicians, and then for non-medical, they really fall into two different categories. One is our logistical staff, so that's technical logistics, so people that have experience in water and sanitation, in supply, in vehicle maintenance, in electricity, and then we have our administrative staff, who are those that are financial coordinators and human resource coordinators. The financial coordinators are those people who come to us with accounting degrees or have worked, managing the books for another NGO or have worked in the financial industry. And then our human resource coordinators are really those who can help us with onboarding our staff and benefits management and all of the kind of day-to-day activities that you need to keep our staff of 41,000 healthy in the field. So what are some of the requirements for you? So if you're interested in applying, we're really looking for those, again, flexibility and availability. For us, all assignments are for 9 to 12 months, except for our operating room staff. So those are our surgeons, our anesthesia providers, and our OBGYNs. Those assignments are for 6 to 8 weeks. And the reason is it's not New York headquarters asking for the length of assignment to be 9 to 12 months. It's really because the staff on the ground to have such high turnover is really difficult for the consistency of our project. So we're really looking for a longer term commitment for people who work with us. And then at least 2 years of relevant professional experience and 3 years for nurses. And it's really so that you can hit the ground running. So we're looking for people who have a professional history already and come to the organization really set to do work as they arrive. Other essential requirements are ability to work in an international team. And so for most people, that seems like they think that's going to be the easiest thing when they get to the field. But really, that's one of the biggest challenges for many of our staff, and it's just because you're working in a different environment, and we have over 147 nationalities that work for us. So we really want you to have experience working in multicultural teams, working outside of your normal comfort zone. And so that's why relevant experience working in a developing country or humanitarian context is important to us. Again, reiterating that same idea that once you hit the ground, you can hit it running, so that it's not the environment that's going to throw you off. That's really that you've had that experience and you come to us as a fully formed professional. Managerial teaching and training experience. So we want you to have managed projects or people before you come to the organization. And again, this is just because often in the field, that is going to be your role. So management of others, management of programs, activities, communication skills, computer skills, commitment to our principles. There's no age requirements with the organization, so really it's that you have this relevant professional experience. And also for our medical professionals, that you've practiced 6 months in the last 2 years. So we want your skills to be up to date. And there, couples, often we get many times questions about, can couples go to the field? And really, it's hard for us to place couples, so we ask that you do go individually to the field. And then foreign language skills is a major asset and really one of the biggest language skills that is really relevant to our field programs is French. And that's just because of the top five largest staff projects, two of those are French-speaking countries. So the French skill, language skill, is really relevant to us and really beneficial because it helps to really meet the needs of what our field needs and what language that they're working in. So knowledge of French. But, of course, increasingly knowledge of Spanish and Arabic is also, and any actual language is really beneficial to working with the organization. So what benefits do we provide? So we provide round-trip transportation to and from the field, room and board in the country. So that means that once you get to wherever you're going, for example, I was in South Sudan, MSF had a tent for me. They provided food for me. We had someone that cleaned and cooked our meals for us so that we could really focus on the work at hand. And then also MSF paid for all the visas, all my work permits, all of the things that I needed to fully hit the ground running and be a professional in the country and in South Sudan. We have a starting stipend of $2,039 per month, and that goes into your U.S. bank account monthly, and that increases with experience. And then full health, dental, and vision insurance the entire time you work in the field with us, and then for 3 months after you return. Because what we really want is to build long-term careers for people, and hopefully they'll do multiple assignments with us. So for this 3-month health extension, hopefully you come home to the U.S., you get to rest, and then you can go back to the field. Access to a 401k plan. We have emergency evacuation coverage, so if something were to happen to you or if you needed to get home really quickly, we have that available. You do get vacation days. It's 25 days per 1-year contract with us, and that's prorated depending on the length of the assignment. A lot of people want to know about the benefits. How do they keep in contact with their loved ones at home? How do they get rest to ensure that they can do the work most effectively? And we do have vacation. And then we also do provide psychosocial care support for you before you go to the field, while you're in the field, and after you return. And then MSF does qualify as a public service organization for the forgiveness program. So I'm going to turn it over to Mark to talk about his experiences with us. But just before I do that, just want to let you know this is a pretty quick intro to the organization, and there's so many other ways to get more information specifically about your role, specifically about other aspects of the organization, and here are all the ways that you can stay connected with us. So now I'm going to turn it over to Mark. Oh, and then too, if I know we won't have time in this quick, short 45 minutes to answer all of your questions. But if you do have additional questions, you can always email us at this email address. So please take note of it and send us emails if you have questions. But without further ado, I'm going to hand it over to Mark.
Thank you, Melissa. My name is Mark. I started with MSF in 2015 as a logistician and was in the field pretty consistently for about 3 years in 6 different assignments, 5 different projects for about, as I said, about 30 months. I'm going to take you through a number of slides pretty quickly, trying to show you at least my own experience in MSF. It'll be somewhat linear going through project by project, and I'll be highlighting some of the activities we were doing, what my own personal role was, what some of the challenges were, perhaps around security, around team life, around living situations, and some other things I just want to highlight to give you a picture of at least my own personal story in MSF and to an extent a reflection of what one might expect in the field. So quickly, this is a summary of my assignments, but this I will talk about this as we move on. This was my last assignment in Balakali refugee camp in Bangladesh. So I put 2 slides here at the beginning just to kind of highlight two of the more impactful projects, the second one being on the Aquarius rescue ship in the Mediterranean. A little bit about myself. This is kind of my third career professionally. I was a social worker and educator in Chicago for a while. Went back to graduate school in international development. Went back into construction management, which is what I had done kind of throughout my college and early 20s. And then came to MSF a little bit later. What's interesting is I was able to draw, I think, on a lot of the skills that I had done professionally. Although I had a diverse background, I found in MSF that variety of skills was what was well received. Here we could just very quickly, this is Tigray, Ethiopia. The first project was a startup refugee health project working in the north of Ethiopia. So we were focusing on mental health. We also had a hospital in one of the refugee camps. This is just a quick picture. When I started off, we were living in a really nice town, high elevation, which meant it was cool, good food, nice security environment. All the while building a compound in this hot, dusty refugee camp to be closer to the beneficiaries, which is what we do. So it's an interesting kind of just comparison. You can see here when I started off, I had my own room, bathroom, nice, well-built cinder block building. And then at the end, here we are in the refugee camp. Also nice. We had a generator for power. We had water. People did have individual rooms, but it was a more restrictive security environment. There wasn't anything to do so much at night. But there's always a kind of team life, as Melissa touched on. I mean, it's one of the best parts of working in the field. It's also one of the more challenging parts. You're working and living with the same people every day. These are your managers. These are sometimes people that you're managing, even with an international staff team. And, you know, we'll talk about it a little bit, but I think one of the most important things from my perspective is just to really focus on your mental and physical health and to be aware of the stressors. As Melissa also said, there are a number of resources that MSF does provide to help people with this. My second project was in South Sudan. Now, while in Ethiopia, at least in the first part, there was a big market with lots of supply, with where you could go out and have dinner. Here, they dropped you off in a helicopter. It was a six-month assignment. You had holiday at 3 months, one R&R to the capital, Juba. But you couldn't go out at night. You couldn't go out by yourself during the day. It was still it was an awesome project. It was primary health care, so we were doing, the medical teams were seeing large numbers of outpatient consultations every month and then doing referrals to our partner facility, which is a few hours by way. The partner facility in a town called Agak in northern Sudan was 3 hours, 2.5, even when it was dry. It could take up to 10 when it was wet during the rainy season. Here I was doing construction. So in the first project I showed up in Ethiopia, just to go back a bit, I did supply, technical logistics, a lot of vehicle movement management, a lot of national management of our Ethiopian staff. Here in Mayom, South Sudan, I was doing construction. So I showed you a little bit the first picture, which was the before. After, when I left, we had built all these nice tukuls. People had their own place to live. But in the beginning, it was tense. It was wet. It was quite rough for all of us living in the compound. I also did some work on the medical facilities as well. I like this slide because it kind of shows what we get to do in the field working with limited resources. This is a challenge, of course, I mean, particularly from the medical side. Also, the logistical side is making do with what you have. But this is really fun. I mean, for me, somebody who did construction and was working in cities, doing really conventional construction management, to get to go back and work with in a resource challenged environment, I thought was really fun. Here we are, just a quick, you can see how dry it was. This was the helicopter we would take to work. A great team, pretty big team here in Mayom. Living situation, again, it was, sometimes it could be nice. We had, you know, you have cooks who help, you know, cook food. There's cleaners that can help with just kind of laundry and things like this, so you can focus on work. There is some downtime. You're usually working between 5-6 days a week. In an emergency, it can be all the time. All the more reason to focus on your mental and physical health. This is just, I like to show this for the logisticians out there. You're stuck in the mud a lot. In fact, if you're a medical person, you're also going to be stuck in the mud, and you'll find yourself with a shovel in your hand, perhaps, during the rainy season in South Sudan. This here, if you can tell on YouTube and Facebook, these are all bugs. There were so many bugs in this project. This was actually beyond the stresses of team life and eating goat every day and it being almost 120 degrees sometimes. And this latrine you see on the bottom left, which was your bathroom, the bugs were kind of are what, for a lot of people, almost, it was particularly intense. They would come in these waves of two-week increments. There was a water and sanitation team that would try to, manage it, but it was a consideration. After that, I went onto the Mediterranean in a rescue ship. At that time, the one I was on was called the Aquarius. Here is just a quick two pictures of what we would come across when we were patrolling the waters. Usually, we would find these rubber rafts on the right side of the screen. They would immediately start taking on water as they were pushed off of the Libyan coast. We would be in international waters at that time with the help of the Italian Coast Guard trying to find them, and also European Coast Guard more generally, but usually would find these small rafts. There could be 150, even 200 people crammed onto these things they would order off the internet. Sometimes there were more substantial boats. You can see here, like this blue one. We would bring people on board. We would triage them for medical conditions. We saw a lot of fuel burns, a lot of acute medical conditions from the time that the refugees were spending in the detention camps in Libya, those who had spent time there, which was a majority while I was on the ship. We would feed them, give them clean clothes. As I mentioned, if they had medical conditions, we had a clinic on board that would see the most serious cases first and then do more general consultations as the 2 or 3 weeks of the voyage went. At this time, we were bringing the refugees to the nearest safe port as dictated by international maritime law, which was Sicily. Very dramatic. We had at one point 946 people plus one, a baby girl that was born on board. While I was there, you can see we'd evacuate by helicopter. It was quite an intense project. This is a picture of the baby girl that was born and all of us after the rescue. We would be doing, on the right side here, you can see that much of what we'd be doing would be feeding the refugees. It could take at least half the day to do two hot meals, and then we would have water and snacks throughout the day to keep people fed. Not always glamorous as a logistician. I started off as a logistician, did some time as a project coordinator, but here it's, it's somewhat funny. I mean, it was about 4 a.m. We had spotted a bunch of rafts. We were bringing people on board and the toilets were leaking. So you can imagine 300, 400 refugees coming aboard your ship. You need to get that working. I like to show this slide. Much of what we did was, of course, to treat the acute medical needs on the ship, to provide people safe passage, to make sure they were warm, they didn't have hypothermia, that they were fed. There were some mental health and other support that we were able to offer, but very limited in the few days they'd be on board. The especially vulnerable people, women, children, victims of torture, we would refer to agencies on shore so that they could have some continued support as they moved on. The juxtapositions in MSF can be quite intense. Of course, you saw hundreds of refugees sleeping out in the cold on a hard deck. We would drop them off into a further unknown and then go have a wonderful dinner in Sicily. So here the team life, we slept in cabins. It was quite nice. As I mentioned, it was quite difficult when I was in South Sudan and then in Ethiopia, just going back, it varies. Sometimes you have good food in a strong market, local market for food. Other times you're eating goat every day. And maybe a few vegetables that are flown in on an airplane so you don't destabilize the local vegetable market. The next project I did was in South Sudan. Again, this was a mobile clinic project. Quite high security. We were negotiating access across conflict lines. I started off here as a logistician, helping to start this project and kind of build the compound. And then I became project coordinator later. This was a lot of security management, making sure that we were communicating with the relevant stakeholders to cross these lines, to provide care for people who were cut off because of fighting for up to a couple years from medical care. You'd literally be coming into towns and there'd just be, I mean, just tons and tons of sick people, usually just malaria, which is very easy to treat, very deadly, very easy to treat as long as you can get to the people. Very small team here. Now I've heard, which is quite nice, it's grown quite a bit and it's become established, but at that time it was a very small team. Melissa talked a little bit about the dynamics of team life. I've touched on it too. Sometimes it can be a big team where you have private space you can go to at night. Other times it can be especially small team. This is a very small compound. So again, this is wonderful. You make very strong relationships with some people. There's challenging relationships with others. But it's something to be aware of, and certainly when you go to the field, if you choose to be cognizant of throughout your time, how you manage that. We slept in this tent, although there was a little house that served as our office, so we would sleep in this tent. Five snoring guys. We had a tent for the women and a tent for the men. For me, one of the biggest stressors was how loud people snored at night. I mean, it seems kind of small, but when you're exhausted after a long day, it's a big deal. We would take a little. We often take these little planes in MSF. My last project in Bangladesh, I just got back from. At this point, I was a project coordinator. This was a huge project. There's a million Rohingya, as you might know now, who have moved over from Myanmar because of most of them since 2017 summer because of ethnic cleansing there, but also over the past 20 of years, amount to about a million Rohingya now living in a number of camps. So here we had. While in Ethiopia, the first time it was mainly mental health with a hospital. In South Sudan, it was primary health with referrals to a hospital on the boat. It was emergency medical care. And mobile clinics, the second time I went back to South Sudan, and the third time. Here we had a huge package. We had a full hospital, a number of hospitals actually within MSF. But under my the project I was working with, a hospital, a number of primary health care facilities, mental health programs, sexual and gender-based violence programs, epidemiological and outbreak response activities, huge water and sanitation activities, big outreach program, working with traditional birth attendants because there was low health-seeking behavior, and one of the biggest challenges would be that pregnant women would deliver out of facility. Extremely interesting project, but a team of 600, large organizational structure, here I just show, this is where the international staff house. You can see it was quite comfortable, good food, great market. When I say market, it's the ability to go out and buy food, which you can't always do, either because of food scarcity, because food's not there, or you don't want to affect the prices. This is one of our clinics in the Balakali camp. This is what some of the condition was during the rainy season. It was quite serious. You can see, I mean, literally these shelters would fall down these hills. Again, on the right side, another one of our clinics. See, a lot of what we do in MSF, most of what we do is we go in and we try to do an appropriate response for the needs. So we don't often go in and build huge hospitals. I mean, a bamboo and plastic sheeting hospital can be just enough to meet the needs given the resources available. On the left is a latrine, which is in a huge puddle of water in a river. Of course, if anybody out there listening is interested in water and sanitation, this is very bad. You have cholera, you have a number of waterborne diseases. This is a big part of what we do, especially on the logistical side. I put this slide here because, for the doctors and nurses listening, I mean, this is the logistical activities are in support of your activities to serve the beneficiaries, but there's a huge logistical response that goes behind that. As Melissa talked about, this is a big supply warehouse we had in Bangladesh, one of many. Supply team here doing inventory. And I think for me, on a personal and professional level, one of the greatest parts of my field work has been working with such amazing people. We do here, this was a staff meeting we had in Bangladesh. It might have also been a training we were given. Or we would be providing. I think I'm at about 15 minutes here. In closing, I guess what I've run through here is, I mean, just some of my own personal experience in MSF. One of the things we really talk about is managing expectations. So you do go to the field to keep an open mind, to be adaptable, be flexible, certainly to be committed to the availability you say. At least that's what I've found. And that it can be quite varied. There can be projects, usually not your first mission, where the food is fine, where the security is fine. Typically, you'll find yourself in a more high security context, perhaps living in a compound where you can't go out at night, taking airplanes to work. I don't know if you wanted to add anything. Did I touch on it? Yeah.
Thank you. Well, no, just stay. Okay, so now it's really the question to answer your questions, and so Chelsea and Pinar have been recording them, so really want to give this opportunity to answer your questions. Yeah, and please keep sending them in.
Okay, so we do have a question. We've got several here, but one particularly, Missy, perhaps maybe because you're the recruiter, what relevant work experience in a developing country or humanitarian context would be best to prepare an applicant for MSF?
So I would say it depends on your profession. So if you are a medical...
A nurse.
So I would say if you're a nurse, to work with a humanitarian NGO before you come to us. So that could be working with another organization, really trying to work with limited resources, work in security contexts, work in a complex situation. I would say for your logisticians, for your financial administrators, if you can work with an NGO, doing those things such as, managing books, helping an organization with their HR practices, just so that you've already had this type of humanitarian experience before coming to us.
Another question we received, I guess this is also to Missy, is my husband works with MSF as a PC, and I'm wondering if we could work together. So I guess the general question is, can couples or family members go to field together?
So it is hard to place people together on assignments just because of the nature and the security. Like if you saw Mark's pictures, in some of the places for international staff, you only have as many international staff on the ground as can fit into a plane, just because of security situations. So what I would say for her, or him, whoever their partner is just really talk to their partner and have their partner talk to their pool manager about opportunities for family placements. We don't have that many for them for working in this organization, again, because of the types of the situations that we work in complex settings. But there are some ways once you build a career with MSF that you can maybe be posted in a more secure, stable setting and then have your family accompany you.
So we have a question from Krista, and she's a BSN RN with leadership experience, and she wants to know what she should be doing in the next 3 to 5 years to best prepare and be the best possible candidate.
Yeah, great. So for nurses, I would say a couple of things. One, to work on your nurse supervision or nurse management skills. So taking on the responsibility of charge nurse. And then for the skill set, it's always pediatrics that is extremely important and infectious disease. So, and then just basically building your nursing skill set so that you feel really comfortable. So a lot of times people spend a couple years in med-surg, then they focus in pediatrics. All of those types of skills, also working in different types of settings. So I would say people that have worked with Indian Health Services, people who have worked with underserved populations in the U.S., so working with populations that might not have access to healthcare or, don't have reliable insurance. Here, I think those are definitely, or immigrant populations here in the U.S., all of those skill sets really kind of round you out professionally. So I would say, Krista, to highlight on all of those things would be really important.
We also have a question for Mark. Our viewer Benjamin is asking about your pre-MSF career history.
Hi. Yeah, I am. As you know, I kind of touched on in the beginning, this is my third career. I decided I wanted to work in the humanitarian sector. My mid-20s, I had been doing construction management and working as a youth counselor and educator in Chicago prior to that. Not knowing I really wanted to join MSF, I went back to school for international development and got my master's, and then went back doing construction management for a number of years. This just to say that I eventually decided that MSF was the best fit for what I'd wanted to do for a while, but kind of took a while getting to. I think people have different paths. Some people know they want to join MSF right away. It took me a little while to get here. Yeah, it's a nice organization for people who are very directed professionally. It's great if you're directed in relevant areas. But if you have a diverse background, if you've moved around a little bit, perhaps your skills will also fit, I think. Not to speak about recruitment, but that was my experience.
Yeah.
Yeah,
I can just – I've worked with the organization now 10 years. I started as – I've always – really tried to focus my career around social justice or working in the nonprofit sector. So I spent the first 10 years of my career working on building my leadership management skills and was a director of a department that put on large-scale events for a nonprofit in New York City, and then went back and got my master's degree at night, and then found out about MSF from an international perspective and came to the organization. So I think really aligning with the principles, really, and kind of if this is your goal, because as Mark and I both can attest to, you know, and you guys saw, it's not the money that's motivating you to work for MSF. It's really the principles and your commitment to, I think, working for an organization like MSF that really helps to formulate that purpose. Because often in the field, that can feel, you can get lost. I don't know if you want to say anything.
I think it's a good point. Absolutely.
Yeah.
So we've got a question for both of you. So I'll address the different questions to each of you. So for Missy, what support does MSF provide to field workers in the field and then after returning home from assignment? And Mark, how did you manage your mental health and wellness in the field?
So for support for, we have a psychosocial care unit here in the New York office. So if you're an American working with us in the field, you have access to her and she'll help you provide, you know, get you ready to go to the field. And then while you're in the field, you have, you know, she can help you through difficult situations. And then when you return, she will do a debriefing with you. And then we also have groups of returned MSF volunteers. So there are people that have worked with the organization and we have hubs set out throughout the U.S. where when you come back, you also have a network of people who've done like-minded work, who've worked for the organization that can support you. Because often you get back from the field and, you know, people want to know about your experience for about 2 minutes and then they want to, you know, they moved on. And so it's really helpful to have that return volunteer network to support you.
Yeah, to reiterate the point about PSU, the psychosocial support unit, all the different operational centers, that's down the road, maybe if you're more interested in MSF, you'll learn the organizational structure. But all the offices, the main operational offices, have psychosocial support. We also have it directly in MSF-USA. So if I was stressed in the field, I could always reach out to professionals who could give me some advice. I think practically what I would do is I would really work on my stressors and coping mechanisms, like being honest with what I was capable of, trying to be honest with how I felt, making sure I got enough rest. I got exercise as I could, even if it was running around the compound or doing some push-ups. But then also knowing when I was getting stressed out and recognizing that in myself, if physiologically and having already thought about what I would do to make sure that I was able to stay, you know, healthy myself, but also remain a good manager and remain a good teammate, and not to let that stress affect my decision making. So generally, it's just to really be honest with myself and conscious of my limitations, knowing when to ask for support, doing so, and then also having people to talk to at field level as well, whether it was my colleagues or my managers. Oftentimes, it would be just people and my colleagues at night after dinner sitting around. It's an excellent question.
This is for Mark. When in the field, do you have any contact with family, friends, or loved ones at home?
All the time, yeah. Most projects now, by and large, have pretty good communication technology. So you can expect to have internet. It might not work all the time, but it should be good enough for an occasional WhatsApp or Skype call. You know, with email, text messaging, or WhatsApp. So, yes, usually I would always tell my family, don't expect that I'm going to call you at 6 p.m. on Tuesday because the internet might be down then. But maybe a little bit later on Tuesday, it'll be back up and I'll be able to call. So, yeah.
Right. So we have just a general recruitment question. Which roles are high need in the field right now? We have a med lab tech asking with infectious disease focus.
So I think really the big needs in the field now are supply logisticians, so people that have skills with procurement, warehousing, so on. Then also IPC nurses, so nurses that have experience or professional experience in infection prevention. And we're really looking for pediatric anesthesiologists. Again, that's for our couple of our programs in Liberia. We have a surgical program that's really needing that skill set.
One of our viewers is asking how long the recruitment process takes.
Yeah.
Them applying.
That's a good question. So I would say if you're interested in applying, I would apply 4 to 6 months before you're ready to go to the field. And it's just because we have an online application, we have a phone interview, we have an in-person interview, and then we have a non-technical training. So it's all part of the induction course or induction to working for MSF. So, and that does take a while, but great question.
We have another question. Do you get to decide where you are assigned in the field?
No, unfortunately. We really are asking for people who are flexible, adaptable, and willing to go where the needs are. So that's why we do these types of recruitment sessions, because sometimes people have very specific ideas of where they want to be placed in the field. But really what we're looking for is for people who are willing to go wherever the needs are.
And what are some of the challenges in terms of cultural awareness and working in international teams? Can you speak more to sort of what some of the rewards are with that and just your national staff colleagues?
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, it can be one of the most challenging, like Mark talked about, when you're tired and you're coming back somewhere and you're sleeping and those type of team challenges that you don't necessarily fully understand working in the U.S. context, where you can leave your coworkers at the end of the day. But what I would say is one of the biggest rewards is that you have an opportunity to work together, to really create this team dynamic with people from 147 nationalities. So on most of my assignments, I was the only American and the only one maybe with my cultural background. And that is just extremely rewarding because how often do you get to work with people from, at least for me, from Sudan and from Malawi, and so it's this cultural richness that helps decision making and helps our projects be much more innovative, lean, interesting, because there is 140 different ways of approaching situations at the table. So that's one of the big reasons why we have travel or we have working with people that are unlike yourself is so important to the recruitment criteria. And that's just because when you're in the field, we want you to have practiced that. We want you to have cultural responsiveness or cultural competency before you come to the organization, because it just makes the team and our medical activities so much more robust.
This is for Mark. It's, I guess, more of like a personal question. During your time in the field, someone's asking, what was the hardest part of being in the field?
And also, Mark, just to tie into Melissa's question, if you wanted to talk about your experience with national staff.
It's a good question. For me, I think it was slowing down, knowing when to slow down. There's always an emergency, or it feels like there is. There's always something to do. And to making sure I was getting sufficient rest. I was trying to disconnect from the work in a structured way. And it was a challenge. Yeah, I think that was the biggest one. To draw on your point, I agree with what Melissa said. I'm just thinking about a story that early on as a manager, you know, when I was managing people in New York, if somebody was late or if there was something we had to fix, I would just go up to them in the group and say, why were you late? And how are we going to fix this? I did that once, I think it was in South Sudan, and in a measured way, but nonetheless, one of my colleagues came up and Mark, you know, culturally, you really should not redirect people in public. People lose face, and in this community, it's a really, really big deal. And I didn't know that. I mean, this is something that I was totally reasonable from where I was coming from, but in that context, it wasn't. I remember that story a lot. Practically, when I always will talk to people in private now, if there's an issue we have to really work through. But it also really got me to reminded me of all those good briefings I had in New York before I left, to really think about this.
So we just have a couple more before we wrap up. So Douglas wants to know, would Peace Corps work experience count towards professional experience?
So I think Peace Corps is really relevant experience to working with the organization because the mandate of Peace Corps, of course, is this cultural exchange, and so it helps definitely to build skills. But if that was the only experience, unless it's like the Peace Corps response or if you're working in the Peace Corps like as a nurse, then we actually do want an additional relevant professional experience. So Peace Corps is highly valued and sought after experience for working with MSF, but we also want additional professional experience.
We also have a question about once someone's accepted into the pool, the question is, how do you prepare the employees before an assignment, meaning is there an orientation period?
This is for both of you. So just for me as a logistician, so in New York we have a 3-day induction course, which is just like an information, just to get you prepared. Then we have briefings before you go to the field. And in some cases, especially in like logistics and almost every profile now, you have additional technical training. So I had a week-long technical training learning about our systems around supply, our vehicle maintenance, water bladders, vaccination campaigns, supply management. So a week-long technical training before I went to the field. And then you have briefings along the way with different technical reference, different professionals that help you get to the field so you can hit the ground faster. And I don't know, Mark, if you want to talk about that.
Yeah, I mean, I think that was my experience too. I have had a lot of really good support before I left and really in the field too, but I've also, there's been times where I haven't had support. So usually it's there, but maybe when you're in the field, when I was a logistician, your logistical coordinator is on an extended holiday, maybe there's a gap. So absolutely, I think MSF does a really good job to prepare people and to provide resources while you're in the field as well. But a lot of times you have to just make do with what you have. And again, I think that ties into the adaptability and flexibility that for me was, I would think about that mantra, you know, in a way.
So we do have a security question, which I think both of you are great to answer. So how does MSF manage security and what are the biggest security concerns while on assignment?
So MSF manages our own security, so meaning that we our number one security is quality medical programs and acceptance in the communities that we're working. So Mark can speak specifically, being a project coordinator, one of his roles, of course, was to manage that security. A lot of it is conversation, ensuring that people know what we're doing, making sure that we're abiding by our principles of neutrality, independence, impartiality, making sure people know who we are, that we're providing free quality medical care. And then it's also about the individual on security. So there's strict, usually in working in MSF, depending on the context that you're working in, you may have limited movement. You may always have to have a radio with you. So depending on the context and the context that we work in are ever evolving, that security management might be changing and adapting. And so you have to be willing to understand the security guidelines that we have put in place and then abide by them. But I'll just let Mark highlight about being a project coordinator in security.
Yeah, I think you touched on most of it. I mean, as a project coordinator, it's your primary job. To do this, you're drawing on a lot of resources MSF has internally with almost 50 years of experience, you know, working in very challenging contexts. So there's a lot of conventional security management that we bring to bear. There's also a lot of local context analysis that's done, so that's very important. They're developing relationships with different community actors, armed actors, at both the project level within the villages and the towns, and also at the capital level. And there's people who are full-time doing this at the capital level as well. So there's a lot of that's happening. We also rely, all this goes into the local security plan, which we all have to follow. So I think from a management side, we're bringing, you know, in a multifaceted way, trying to get the best information we can about the context, you know, cross-checking it, checking with other partners, other actors, you know, to make the best decisions and understand what's going on. But also, to your point, you're also an individual, even when you're a PC, of course. And I think a really important thing for me, also before I became project coordinator, was to just really understand my own feeling of safety, making sure I was communicating security concerns to my PC, to my manager. I was actively engaged in security awareness. And fundamentally that I trusted in the security management, and at least that I felt the risks were acceptable. And if I didn't, or if I had questions, to make sure I was asking and I was talking about it. MSF also has a commitment that's always been explained to me, that if you do feel really unsafe and that you want to leave the project for security reasons, you know, or really for any reason, that as soon as it's safe to do so, you can leave. Mm-hmm. So it's good to know that as well.
We're wrapping up here, but we have two final questions. One is, our viewer is asking what happens if an MSF field worker becomes injured or ill during their project time.
Mm-hmm. So it depends on what type of illness. In some circumstances, you can be treated right at the field level because we are a medical organization. If it's a more serious injury, you may have to be medically evacuated, and we have evacuation protocols and insurance to cover that. Yeah.
And the final question is, does MSF organize events where our viewers might be able to find out more information and talk to our field workers?
Definitely. So if you sign, well, actually, I'm going to throw that one to Chelsea.
Sure. All right. So our three recruiters travel around the country throughout the year. We might be changing that structure up a bit the next year, but we will be doing more live events throughout the coming year, and we will also be posting our events on our website. So make sure you're checking our website, making sure you're looking at our recruitment pages, especially the essential requirements page, where you can find out what the minimum requirements are to apply for going to the field. And those apply to all people applying to MSF to go to the field, and then look at the profile pages just to see what competencies, skill sets you need in order to go to the field with us. And then once you've kind of evaluated your skill set, where you're at, if you have additional questions, you can follow up with us via the email that we provided in the comments section, or you can just submit your application. If you feel ready to apply, you know, every person who applies with us will get feedback on their application. So if you're not quite sure you're there, or if you think you're confident in your skill set, you're ready to apply, I think we just would encourage you to apply, and then you'll get that feedback. So,
yeah. Great. I think that's all I've got.
You guys want to
just sit? Thank you. Well, thank you for your time, and we really hope that you do apply.
Take care. Thank you.
Bye. All right.
Thanks, everyone.